Good morning, everybody. My name is Chris Sanders from the CICMQ program, and I'm really pleased to welcome you all to this 94th Zoom call for CICMQ 11s. It's great to be here. This is 1 year ago tomorrow that we did our first one, and many of the people, I'm really pleased to say, are still on this call. And we're on the first one as well, mainly because they got on our database and they've not been allowed to go off it. So I'm very, very pleased to welcome today Nick Williams from Equinix. Nick is a senior manager for EMEA for credit and collections. Just so to give you some logistics stuff, Nick has got a presentation we're going to run through at the moment. My camera's on this screen. If I'm looking away, it's because the presentation is over there. Okay, just to let you know. So I'm just going to share my screen now and hand over to Nick. We've still got people joining, so I'll be letting them in as we go through. Okay, let me just share my screen. Okay, and if you can give me a thumbs up if you can see that. Great stuff. Thank you very much, Lou. Okay, and I'm going to stick that in presentation mode. When you want me to move the slides on, Nick, just let me know.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. And good morning to everybody. And I guess Chris asked me to do this a couple of months ago, and he pinged me last week. He said, "Oh, you are still okay for next week," and I kind of forgotten all about it. So it was kind of a rapid presentation together. But the topics I want to talk about are fairly easy for me to talk to, and actually really don't need the slides to do that. So two main objectives for me out of today were one, to get more than two people on the call, i.e. more than Chris and I, and we've achieved that. And with 1,900 people over the year, that's pretty remarkable. And two really was for every person to take something away from what I'm talking about today, and either, you know, something that you think that's a great idea, or something that maybe for the future that you could think, you know, you could maybe work into your organization. And I appreciate that everybody works in a very different organization, different setups. Your people have different requirements and different needs, and you know, everybody has to find their own way of working. So this is how you should do things. This is just how we've done things at Equinix. So Chris, if we can go through the next couple of slides, please. That'd be great. So we're just going to quick introduction about Equinix. I'd like to reflect on 2020. And then we're going to talk a little bit about looking forward, and then we'll do some Q&A, which is pretty the most important bit at the end. So, okay. So next slide, please, Chris. So I thought it'd be easier to start because, as Chris says, Equinix is probably one of the biggest companies in the world that you have never heard of. And that's because the service we provide is not out there in the marketplace, but it's absolutely fundamental to the world that we live in today. And Chris, if we can go to the next slide, that'd be great. And I thought it's good to kind of visualize it for you. So we own data centers, and we operate and run data centers. And probably in the past, they were big concrete buildings, which were pretty ugly, stuck in the middle of nowhere. Today, we're very energy efficient. Our buildings, you can see, are artistically designed and look incredible. But within there, we house thousands and thousands of other companies' servers, and we interconnect those servers from one another. So a number of you will be customers of mine. You just don't know that. And we just link everybody together. So Chris, next slide, please. So we were founded in 1998. We're headquartered over in Redwood City, which is just outside of San Francisco. And we are the world's leading digital infrastructure company. And when I say leading, we are significantly larger than any of the competitors around us. Our aim really is to be able to allow all of our customers to connect to each other at the drop of a hat, and really deliver that world-class service that they need. And I've just given you a couple of quotes there from companies that, you know, that are customers of ours. And probably one of the most personal is at the bottom there is Zoom itself. You know, our business with Zoom has grown exponentially since lockdown. Our service has become really, really super important to every single customer in the world. Our revenues is quite a success story. 6 billion we've just announced for 2020, and that's up from 3.6 million in 2016. Now we have some acquisitions in there to help that number, but you know, we are a company that grows, and we are world leading in 72 quarters of consecutive growth, which I had to put it in brackets because that'll take me a while to work out otherwise. And that's 18 years we have consecutively grown every single quarter, and that is some record. And we're forecasting, you know, between 7 to 8%, maybe 10% growth for 2021 as well. 6,000 employees worldwide. My department here in EMEA is around the 35 mark, and that's made up predominantly of a team here in Slough. And also we have an offshore team that supports with some of the back office functions as well. We did the accreditation a couple of years ago, and we renewed that in 2020. And we're really proud to have that. So next slide, please, Chris. This kind of just gives you an idea of where we're at across the world. We have over 220 data centers in the world, over 10,000 customers, 63 metros across 26 countries. And our reliability is, as you can see, is just short of 100%. And that's super important, because if our coolers fail in our data center, your servers overheat and your whole service goes down, it takes your company out of business for a period of time until we can get things back up and running. So the reliability and the service we provide is super important. But global reach, all of our data centers are connected to one another. So undersea cables, you may have seen on the news recently, there was talk about the Navy protecting undersea cables because the Russians are up to no good with their submarines. But again, these are the super important things that we have, you know, land insights that come in and we continue to build new data centers. The several go up every year. So next slide, please, Chris. So that was just a short kind of intro on Equinix. And now I'd like to kind of talk a bit about 2020. And of course, everybody has their own story. So next slide, please, Chris. So in summary, I just wanted to share four statistics with you, really. In 2020, we took 46% out of our debt that's greater than 60 days past due. We collected an all-time record of $2.2 billion. We closed on average over 3,000 customer inquiries, queries, business queries every single month. And from the start of the year to the end of the year, we actually reduced our total accounts receivable balance by over $100 million. They are by far and above our greatest results ever. And then you factor in that no one's actually sat around a desk since in office environment since March last year and the pandemic. And, you know, customers have needed support to get through these times. And Equinix has been able to provide that support to customers to help them get through and survive. And interestingly enough, I found through my entire work in life, actually, you tend to get asked more questions about why you're doing well as opposed to why you're not doing so well. And really, I'd like to now talk about, you know, how we did this. So Chris, if we can go to the next slide. I looked across four main pillars, really: performance, people, stakeholder engagement, and initiatives. And we've really aligned ourselves with our billing team. In the past, I used to be in competition with them. It was always important that, you know, my department stood out, our results were noted, and we did the best we could. Over time, that kind of philosophy has to change, and you realize without your billing team working with you and alongside of you, you can't succeed. And as you can see how many queries we've resolved, our billing team similarly has a slightly larger number of queries every single month and questions in the business that they have to solve. Dan, who's my kind of counterpart on the billing team, quite often recalls that he speaks to me now more than he does his wife. So that it just goes to show how far we've come in terms of our relationship, not that way, but, you know, that relationship in the work environment. So when I dive into things like performance, what we find is Equinix is a fast-paced, moving company. Nothing ever stays the same. And those priorities change from month to month, from quarter to quarter. But one thing I've found is that those changing priorities actually take you away from the core aspect of what your job is. And ultimately, we're there to collect cash and we're there to support the team. And we have to manage those changing priorities that the business requires, that our customers require, against actually bringing the cash in the door and making sure our team is supported. We found that aligning our account base across with the sales teams and with the billing teams has been instrumental. Trying to reduce the number of days in our whole collection process. We use automated dunning, as I'm sure most people do, but the actual number of days between each stage was quite long and lengthy. So we've shortened that process. We manage our kind of incoming queries, and we call them like breaches, if they breach SLOs. We didn't have a single breached SLO through the whole of 2020. And the billing team is working hard to clear their backlog with an aim to match ours by the end of this year. We use Salesforce to kind of manage our queries and our caseload. And we're targeting now to really reduce the number of cases that are older than 31 days. Into people, I think motivation is the main aspect for us, and it's how do you manage, you know, and maintain people's motivation, different scenarios from working from home. And there's no real single answer that does that. You have to know your individuals personally, and you have to tailor your kind of ways of working and kind of management to their individual needs. We look at personal goals and development. Our senior analysts, you know, we brought them into our motivational maps training and looked at how they can develop, how they work as a team. We've kind of refreshed on people, on the expectations that we have of people. And we've got an SME program that we've launched to make sure that, you know, we're the people that do the job are the ones that give the input to the future look and feel of how things operate. Stakeholder engagement's been super important for us. And over the last 4 years that I've been at Equinix, we've worked really hard to bring ourselves to have a seat at the table. And we have that now. So we have fortnightly calls with our customer care team and alongside the billing team. And that's with the directors. We have a monthly call with the president of EMEA and the managing directors of our main regions. Monthly call with the sales senior vice president to talk about particular customers that are problematic and how that relationship can build. And one step further, really, the business is, again, continuing to evolve in how it aligns its sales team to the customers. And again, being part of that discussion early on helps us to align our team to them. We partner GAM is our global account team. We have some pretty incredible large accounts that, again, it's really important to partner with sales, making sure we're all working towards the same common goal. And then we have robotics. A big part of our business now is automating a lot of the manual transactions that we do. Named accounts is one level below our GAM, and that's got particular strategic importance through 2021. So again, we are currently looking at how do we best support that with our team. And we've had our fair share of customers that have been unable to pay, needed payment plans, needed support, needed concessions to get them through 2020 and through to now. And again, tracking that from a business on a global scale, working with our FP&A teams, our revenue and our commercial solutions team to make sure that we're giving support where it's really and truly needed versus those that are just using it as an excuse to not pay when they've actually never really paid on time either. So that's a little bit of a stakeholder engagement. And then initiatives. I love an initiative. And I think it's really important to have things to work towards, capture them and then kind of drive those forwards. And this is a blend of not just credit initiatives, but of billing initiatives as well. So we looked at trialing, put a credit analyst or a credit controller and a billing person. Could you amalgamate any parts of their role to reduce the number of touch points to our customers to speed up response times? A lot of our customers use purchase orders for their orders, but they never really give us the renewal. And because there's so many and our service is so complicated, it's not a straightforward solution either. So we need to find a better way of managing those. Our prices go up as anybody's do over time. And so again, making sure that we're getting the letters to the right people on time. Of course, this forum here, the CICMQ renewal, and we achieved that and the best practices network, which to be fair, we probably haven't made as much of as we could, but we are talking to the CICM as well separately about how we can make more use of the CICM and CICMQ and the resources available to us. We've already talked about our subject matter expert forum. Hyperscale is a new type of business where global customers take entire data centers from us. So we build it and then they take every single ounce of space in there. And obviously that's reserved for the few that can afford to do that and the few that have the requirements to do so. Audit is a continual pain. I think we operate in something like 17 countries here in EMEA. We have all the local audits, then we have our internal audits and external audits. And so it's a continuous treadmill of audit. And we're trying to persuade our auditors actually, you know, give us the same request with the same wording for all of the territories rather than you slightly tweak the wording, we give you something slightly different. And then you wonder why the results don't match. So again, just working with the auditors to refine that and make it easier for everybody. Customers are using portals. I don't know how many of you have that, but where you have to upload your invoices to the likes of SAP Ariba, Tungsten, Cooper, and those types. And again, more and more people are pushing their AP onto a portal-based product, but it's time-consuming, and it puts the emphasis back on us. And actually, if the invoice isn't 100% correct in the first place, you can't upload it anyway. So it has its complications, but we have to accept that that's a way of doing business today that our customers require. And the last one on there is creating like frequently asked questions for our customers, so that when our care team are being asked things by customers, they don't then have to raise a case to us. Can you go back to the customer and answer this? They have a crib sheet and they should be able to answer certain questions for the customers. And again, just speeding up the whole thing. So that's kind of the four main areas we've looked at. And then the other one thing we did is we assigned a manager to each of those categories, so they owned responsibility for delivery of that. Okay, Chris, next slide, please. I love a quote, and I think it's really important to hear from your people as opposed to us just thinking that we're doing a great job. And I think this came from one of my team recently when we did one of our surveys, and we do lots of surveys here. But I think it just helps you really know that the company is doing the right thing. We've been so well supported right from the very top of our CEO, CFO. You know, everybody's working from home. We don't need to go back to the office until at least July this year. That may be changed based on the outcome of different places and the rules and the regulations at that time. They've supported people with financial help as well to purchase things to be able to work from home. But again, there's a real big thing about making sure that the employees feel safe and nobody has to go back to work until they feel that they're able to do so safely. Okay, Chris, next slide, Pete. So probably one of the most things I'm passionate about is our people. And it's very easy to pay at lip service and actually not do anything about it. So we try, we don't always get it right, by the way, but we try very hard to offer lots of different areas where people can take ownership and responsibility for their future, and where we can help push that forward. Or where people just need to be guided into which way you go. And I've kind of put that into three sections really. So the grow and develop is again, then three subsections. It's based around the on-the-job development, and that's around experience. And we've created a work shadow program. And just to give you an example, two of our staff have both gone through a work shadow program and both been offered full-time roles in those areas kind of shortly after completing their work shadow. Not because they had the most experience, although they were necessarily the person that would have got chosen normally, but they'd gone out of their way to put in their own time and effort outside of their normal day-to-day job working for my department. But again, I think it's really good that not everybody wants to stay in credit, and other people have opportunities elsewhere. Our subject matter expert forum, again, this is something that we've done really badly in the past. We as managers have made decisions and design systems and processes around what we think is right, and that's completely wrong. And what we've now created is this forum where our experts can come together and we seek their views, and they go and talk to their colleagues and their peers, and they solicit and bring the information back to us. And from there, we can make better decisions that actually works for the people doing the job, as opposed to what we think they need to be able to do the job. And then career pathways. We have a careers pathways kind of flow, if you like, and I've just kind of revised that and made it a bit more up to date. But this career path takes you in one of four kind of ways. And, path number one is actually I'm happy doing what I'm doing. I love being in credit. I love collecting cash. I don't want to do anything different. And that's fine. I think it's important that people have an opportunity to just do the job that they love. Other ones take you off in different areas. I'd like to go and work in our financial operations department, FP&A, I want to go and work in GL, or the other one goes, oh, I'd like to go into marketing, legal, tax, and all that sort of thing. So it kind of maps out different directions that people go, and I think that's super important. And then education, I only authorize and pay for CICM training. I have a lot of people ask me for AAT and ACCA, but I have a budget, and I'm very, very strict on the fact that we do CICM only. And I think at one point we probably had, close on 50% of our team were studying for CICM in one kind of phase or another. We have LinkedIn Learning company-wide. We've done a big investment in that. So people are kind of offered to go into LinkedIn Learning, and that gives you anything you want to you know, you go and look at fashion designing if you wanted to. It's not really what we put it there for, but LinkedIn Learning is open to all sorts of topics, and you can pick and choose, do as many or as few courses as you like. But again, we like to push people down that route as well. And then the last one under growing development is exposure. Not everybody knows people. Not everybody's good at networking and building relationships. And part of that for me is making that happen. And we have a big mentoring program under the finance team globally. And, you know, I've been mentoring somebody actually in the accounts payable team. They kind of set out where they want to get to. But again, it's just creating opportunities. And it's sometimes it's about who you know and building those relationships. Second part is training and motivation. So we're making a little bit of a step change this year. Still work in progress largely, but traditionally people go through their standard company base. You know, these are the courses that you've got to do, or, you know, this is the way that we would always go. And we've used things like, and Pam's done a few courses for us, and it's been great having her down on site for the team. Things like negotiation skills and, you know, how to call a customer and all those basics that, you know, most people take for granted. But we want to use that kind of in conjunction with motivation. And I actually, we use a tool called Motivation Maps. And that really identifies all of your motivations and the different areas. And it could be money could be your top motivator. It could be that you like innovation and change. It could be that you like stability. And the thing from that is, there's actually not a great deal of point focusing on what people are really motivated about. It's important you maintain that. But actually, you need to identify what their lowest motivators are and work on that and work with that person to say, right, you don't like innovation and change. And why is that? Okay, and what can we do to kind of really, you know, enhance that? Because if you don't like innovation and change, Equinix probably is not the right company for you, because we will change every single year, multiple times, and the business will continue to evolve. We look at things like, you know, people talk about strengths and weaknesses and opportunities and threats, and weakness isn't a word we particularly like. And somebody's what might define as a weakness as being the opportunity rather than a weakness. And I think it's really important to focus on the opportunities that you can give people. But by the same token, it's really important that people identify their own opportunities and what it is they want to achieve. It's not necessarily for me to say to my team, oh, I think you should be doing this. This is where I think you should go. You can give a view, you have a, you know, you have an opinion on it, but I think really individuals should be encouraged to really identify what it is that they want to do. And the last piece on training and motivation is a phrase that our CEO is very much about, and he's very committed to everybody feeling safe, everybody belonging, and everybody, you know, mattering in the company. And it's super important for our team that they can answer yes to all three of those, because if they can't, then we have some you know, conversations that we need to have to see why that is. And safe could be along, you know, could relate to COVID. You know, I belong could be around diversity, inclusion, and belonging. And I matter. It matters that you have a voice, you have an opinion, and that opinion is listened to and not just swept under the carpet. So again, three simple phrases that are really important to us as a company. And then the last one is about celebrating success. And I'm sure everybody has their own kind of version of this. We have a thing called magical mentions. And actually in the last couple of weeks, I've seen so many come through for the credit team. And that's probably, we are the last group that would normally get these from our internal stakeholders, because the company has a motto, and that is, you know, put the customer at the center of everything we do. And that kind of is really at odds with us collecting money, terminating people's accounts for non-payment, sending them to debt collectors and all that sort of thing. So actually, when we're helping solve customer queries and the sales team and the care organization are taking time to you know, recognize our staff for the part they've played in putting that customer at the center, I think that's super important. And I've made a big thing about recognition for achievements as well, not only at department level. I can, you know, I always try and, you know, give a shout out to somebody within the team, but we have a seat at the table with the president of EMEA now. He recognizes what we do. He talks to the company about the importance of what we do. He shares our results with the entire EMEA-wide team. And then one step further than that is our CFO, and we've often make it onto his presentation decks with our metrics. And again, raising awareness about what you do, how well you're doing, and making sure everybody buys into to the role of, you know, credit is super important. And you know, we've started to work that with them, with the marketing team as well, just to help blend that. So next slide, please, Chris. We do a survey every quarter globally, and it's called the it was called the Pulse Survey. It's kind of, I think the name's changed now. But again, Pulse Surveys are very much about how you feel potentially that day. But we've averaged 84% employee satisfaction in my team through 2020, and I would have taken that every day of the week. I think if you'd have asked me where would you like to be at the beginning of the last year. What it does, it identifies areas where you need to target, where maybe you haven't scored as well against the company average, and that people talk about growth, and we have quarterly conversations and the feedback. So again, it's very high level. It doesn't really give us much other than a steer. So we create our own kind of supplementary survey. We deep dive into those three areas. We ask a bit more detailed questions, and then we're building a kind of a program behind that of, right, what do we need to do differently to make that happen? Or is it just one or two people that you know are feeling that way, and we can address those and do that. And then we go on to our roadmap. But it's, I think the important thing is that, you know, is to act on the results. So number one, you know, the A is acknowledge. You have to acknowledge where you are and the results that you've got. And then you have to collaborate together to say, you know, where do we want to go with that? And then it's about how do we go forward with this? And I think it's really important that those three things kind of all happen together. So next slide, please, Chris. This is just a snapshot of my Pulse action plan. And it's, we've got the results, we're collaborating, we've done some one-to-ones. Tom's my credit manager. He and I, we've got quite a large team, so we split the team into two. And we've done it as a free forum. It's a well-being check-in. It's just a general chat as much as anything. And then, you know, just trying to identify from people what it is that certain things that they're looking for. I think the important part I've already talked about is this individual contribution. And, you know, people really do have to come up with what it is they want and the desired outcome and the changes that they can make, because we can't do it all. We're going to take that data once we've got it. We're going to kind of collate it, work out what we need to do. We're then going to tie that into our motivational maps piece that we're doing. And then we're going to start to go forward with this and tailor programs for small groups of people or individuals, and work out, you know, how do we really invest in people, as I say, not just the grand corporate training plan. And then obviously you have to review how you're doing against the plan. Okay, next slide, please, Chris. I talked about celebrating success, and I wanted to use Jonathan as an example. Jonathan's actually finished his internship with us and actually has a full-time job in the city, which is great. And Jonathan was based up in Nottingham. We never got to meet Jonathan, sadly. He's been stuck in his lodgings and never made it in. And he was desperately sad that he had to leave, but Brexit played a slight part in that as well. But these are the type of comments, how we celebrate success with people. And Jonathan, you know, got his master's degree in banking and finance, far more intelligent than I could ever hope to be. And, you know, but I think his quote there, challenging year, it was very rewarding. He'd never worked in an office before. He'd never worked with the team before. He's never even set foot in our office, but he loved it. He was so enthused about the experience we gave him, and he made a great part. And I even had my team members saying to me that, you know, Nick, what can we do to keep Jonathan? And, you know, unfortunately, Jonathan needed an opportunity sooner rather than later. And so he moved on. But, you know, again, I think it's really important to kind of celebrate people's success. So next slide, please, Chris. So I think I've done a little bit of talking. I'd just like to share some slides with you now, which doesn't involve me talking. And then I'll wrap up after this one. So Chris, next slide. And let's hope technology works.
As the leaves turn brown, and we could be together, baby, as long as skies are blue. You act so innocent now, but you lied so soon. When I met you in the summer, we'll be right back.
Thanks, Chris. So hopefully you could all hear that and it went to plan. So yeah, next slide, please, Chris. So I'd like to just quickly talk about 2021 and what it looks like for us. And really today, this was entitled Evolve or Repeat. And I think you have a choice. You can repeat what you've always done or you can evolve. And I think those that choose to evolve will always be more successful. Your staff will be more passionate. They'll be more engaged. And I think all these 10 disciplines kind of come together and they're all different areas that people can look at and go, yeah, actually, I am part of a team. I make myself accountable. I have integrity. I've got the right attitude. My work ethic is as good as can be. And for Equinix, for us, it's about going harder. It's about going faster. And it's about being stronger. And it's about being epic in everything that we can do. But to do that, every single person that works in my team and all those around us has to be ready to evolve and not just repeat for the sake of doing so. So I think I'll leave with this. I used to have a motto was that you collect today to sell tomorrow. And I think it's really important that the way in which you collect your cash from your customers is super important to supporting your sales team and your business about how you grow for the future. And with that, Chris, we'll go to the next slide.
Okay. Thank you very much, Nick. I'm going to stop sharing now and go to there. What was great about this? I saw this last night, obviously. Just so that you know, it's 44 megabytes, this slide deck, and we couldn't get it across in one hit. So Nick had to split it into three to get it through the various firewalls. And then I knitted it all together, and thankfully I put it in the right order and the technology worked, which is good. So thank you, Nick, so much. That was brilliant and really, really interesting. There's some great takeaways there, as we've seen from the other CICMQ organizations. And one of the greatest takeaways that we've seen, again, from Adecco, from our friends at Tarmac, from the guys at Waitman's, and Pete's on the call, I know, it is absolutely all about the people. You know, and in times like this, that it is the people that make a significant difference. And the amount of investment that you put into that, Nick, as an organization is quite significant. When I saw this, I love that the video clips and what everybody was doing and the dogs. I'm a dog lover myself, so it was great, especially the one that was teased. So when you're the evolve or repeat thing, is this something that goes through the organization?
No, it's actually Tom, who's my credit manager, came up with it, because we do regular lots of presentations and it's about maintaining the motivation of the team. Yeah, so it's just a slogan Tom come up with, and we're just trying to build on that. And I've never been one for standing still. I love technology. I love how you automate. I've always wanted to remove non-value add transactions, as I call them. You know, those keystrokes that you do that do absolutely nothing, add no dollars to the bank. And get rid of those. So it really is trying to get that message across, because not everybody has the ability to have a foresight about what you can do differently. And that's fine. You know, you can't expect that from everybody. But it is trying to get people the message to them, say it's okay for you to come up with some wacky ideas about how you can change, you know, what you're doing every single day of the week. And that's part of the reason for our subject matter expert forum, because again, to a couple of years ago, we made some really bad decisions as a management team, and I'm a little bit more hands off. I don't get into the. I didn't use the Oracle system for the first 2 years I was there, because I just you know, I'm not a fan of getting right into the detail. That's not everybody's cup of tea. I get that. So there's no point me making a decision on Oracle on behalf of my team. They should be the ones making the decisions, and I think that's the real sort of evolve.
Yeah, and we've spoken about this on one of our sessions before, that when you're looking at making decisions as an organization, and this is something that came out of the Military Five, the presentation we did a while back, is that the what is about the managers decide what the what is. You know, that this is what we're going to achieve. The actual how you achieve it is always best handed to the people in the team. so that, because they're the ones that know what they're talking about, with the greatest respect to all the credit managers on the call here, it is the people that do the job that are the ones that really understand it. I also like the thing that you spoke about billing. Yeah, I'm a big advocate of billing, as many people on this call know. And you said that you're blending billing and credit as roles within the team to try and shorten the customer contacts and stuff like that. How's that going? So I did something like that when I did some work at Virgin Media. I mean, how's that going for you?
Do you know what? We tried it. We did a pilot on it, and it was very difficult. I think not being in the office and sitting a billing person who does their job every day of the week and a credit person side by side, so you can share ideas, look at the screen. It's been near on impossible doing that remotely. So we kind of parked it for now. We're going to wait till we get back in the office. But it is.
You have collaborated more with billing, haven't you?
Yeah. I mean, I have a weekly call with Dan, the billing senior manager. You know, that's in the diary every single week. And we talk about the team and the department. And I have, you know, an open forum to go to any one of his team about any questions that I have, and there's kind of a mutual respect in that. And I don't mind admitting it. I wanted my team to be the best in the days gone by. But it's, you have to, again, I've evolved that thinking to actually, I need them working with my team to become the joint best. But Dan, although I see his wife walking backwards and forwards in the kitchen on Zoom when we have our calls, you know, he does tell me he talks more to me than her. So
I've got a question here from Paul. Would you have any knowledge sharing calls with credit management departments in other global regions?
I mean, we have a global team, right? We have for Equinix, we've got a team based in the Americas and in APAC. We have what we call summits, and I think we had one last week actually, and we bring all the managers together for that. So we do share, we do try and globalize, but again, we've made the point, EMEA's leading the way, by the way. We used to be the kicking bag of the company. Over the last 4 years, we've really turned it around, and people come to us now as best in class, which is great. But I think we've floated the idea of our SME forum. And now we're trying to, we've picked the two main topics, which is Oracle, which, by the way, I have used Oracle since now, you know, it was only the first 2 years I didn't use it, but Oracle and Salesforce, which is our kind of query management, case management system. And they're the two big topics. So we're now going to, we've gone from credit added in billing. Now we're going to go out to the wider audience and bring in the regional experts from those other two regions as well. So yeah, so we do
have. So another hobby horse of mine. You measure billing accuracy and stuff like that, clearly, because you have to, given the relationship that you've got with billing.
Yeah. I mean, we have a target. Actually, the company has a global target to reduce the number of credit notes that we issue, and it's there's a customer experience initiative, and the CEO of the company has said this is one of the top initiatives for the company globally. They recognize our billing is so messed up, and people are now understanding it's not actually the billing team's fault. That used to be the default. Oh, you've messed up the billing. As you know, the guys are here just to fix and solve the problem. So there's lots of people involved, lots of initiatives going on, but you know, it's top down these days. It's not just us complaining about it. It's really,
yeah. I mean, that's always the case. I was when I was at Cable and Wireless some years back, I was head of billing and collections, and of course, I picked up billing mainly because, you know, it had such an impact on what we did, and I picked it up, and it was always billing's fault. Everything was billing's fault. Now these poor people were beaten up week after week by everybody in the organization, until we started sort of looking into it. And we built the, you know, everybody knows I love a league table. Until we built things like the league tables and things like that to demonstrate where the billing errors were coming from, and then it started to slow down. When I took over billing, I went to the managing director of the company. I said, "Say, okay, so what? You know, his name is Rob Fisher, one of the best managers I've ever worked for." And he said, "I said to him, so what? You know, what are my objectives, Rob?" Because he gave me the job. And he, I said, what are your objectives, Rob? He said, "I don't care what you do, just fix billing." And that's all he said. So that was my brief. And it is something that constantly gets, we always get sort of beaten up about. So that's good. So the billing piece is interesting. I've got a question here about EDI from Lynn. Yep. We have found EDIs challenging us to be more proactive and measured with our billing. And ironically, our DSO is improving if we delay submission to ensure the invoice is right before attempting it. We're seeing speed is not always the essence. What's your experience?
It's interesting. We don't really use EDI, ironically. I mean, I come from only ever using EDI, and I come to a company that doesn't use it. And that's mainly because we don't have the volumes of invoices. We may have, Hemel's on the call here. Hemel looks after a section of our global accounts. Some are very low invoice quantity, but huge, multi-million dollar values. So EDI, we use EDI, I think it's up in Finland, is the one where it's mandatory. We have to use the tungsten portal in Italy, again, government making sure they get all their taxes. Everything's mandated, it has to go through this portal. So yeah, EDI, no, we don't use it in the main. But I would concur that if you get your billing right, because again, I can only, if I associate EDI to the portals that we have to use, you can't upload an invoice that's wrong. So you have to get it right to be able to upload it. So getting it right first time definitely will improve your kind
of getting paid. Yeah, another one here. It's from David Robbins. We have combined billing and credit control team at a previous law firm. This is to Waitman's point and Pete Taggart, who's on. I worked for, and it worked very well. So Pete Taggart, if you're on, I mean, they've got an invoice assurance team, and if you watch the YouTube video of Wakeman's online, you'll see their invoice, their structure of their team, and they've got an invoice assurance team, which works really well. And I've been a really really strong advocate of that. Let's see what else we've got on here in terms of linking. Yeah, this is Pete said here, linking with the billing team is valuable and worth it. Same here. That's okay. So I'm interested to hear more about the career pathway piece that you've got there. I did something similar like that, and you've got three different pathways depending on what direction you want to take.
I think there's four. And it was at first, the company rolled it out I think 2 or 3 years ago, but it's we've done a whole company reorg, and so it's very much out of date. So I kind of went through and revamped our one, which we've yet to roll out to the team, but I did it in December. So yeah, you go down this path, this imaginary road, and path number one goes off to the left, and actually it says, I'm fine as I am, I love credit control, I don't want to be promoted, I don't want anything more, I just want to do my job, and that's fine. And you shouldn't penalize people for having that viewpoint, and they should be supported in whatever they need. And then pathway two goes off, and it's I want my career to be in credit management. And then under that are the various buckets. So negotiation skills, collection skills, CICM qualifications, and all those. So there's subsections underneath the path. And then the third one goes off on a finance related. You know, a lot of my people seem to want to go down the finance route and be accountants or things like that. So I want to go and work in FP&A, GL, commercial solutions, that sort of stuff. And then the fourth one is off to go and do something completely different. Don't know how you ever ended up in credit, any of you, but now I want to go off and do something completely different. And that's marketing, and that's sales, that's customer service. So they're the kind of four pathways. And I hope that kind of captures, and I'd be more than happy, Chris, to share that visual with you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. If anybody wants to hear more from Nick, just drop me an email, CICMQ@CICM.com, CICMQ@CICM.com. Question here from Atul. Did you find staff performed better working from home while others perform better in the office based on the environment? Do you have a strategy to evolve this mixed methodology in the future?
Good question. Yeah, most definitely. And this is, I had an unofficial working from home policy, which I didn't run by HR. We rolled it out as a kind of a recognition for people doing well, because we've been on a journey. When I first joined, and Hemel was there when I came, it wasn't very, our results were really bad. We were, the punch bag of the global organization. But as we improved, we added that in as a nice to have for the staff. And it's, I think it just started off with one day a month working from home for people. I'd done one of my offsites with my management team, and we revised it. We were going to increase the number of days that people could work from home, and then COVID hit. But long and short of it is, yes, some people adapt super, super well to it. Other people can't stand it. And some people want a blend of both. And I think it's really important. We did a few of us got back to the office for a couple of days before the lockdown happened again. And I kind of deliberately went, I mean, I live the furthest away, but I went in the office deliberately to try and, you know, everybody wanted to come in and say hello. We did that for a week or so, but then we got locked down. But going forward, the company has set up these different profiles, and our job as credit and collections and billing will fall into one, I think it's one of seven profiles. You'll have sales, customer service, the IBX operations team who have to be in the IBX every day of the week. There's no getting away from that. And I think we fall somewhere in the middle as a kind of service provider to the company. And I don't know what it looks like yet, but there will be a definite blend of probably a couple of days a week from home and maybe 3 days in the office, because we are a collaborative, innovative company. And I love being nothing more than being around the table, having those conversations with people. And you don't get that on Zoom. I find that really difficult to get that real sort of passion out of people.
Yeah, we've had a number of surveys that we've done on the various Zoom calls and stuff that I've taken part in, and a workshop we did last week, which Gail was on, and we did surveys, and it's generally sort of 88% of people say that they want to work in some sort of a hybrid environment going forward.
I agree.
It seems to be the sensible thing.
Yeah, I miss doing some of my offsites in pubs. We used to rent the restaurant of a pub and have our meetings there, and then it kind of naturally works nicely at 5 o'clock, where you just slide across into the bar.
Give us a job. When the pubs open, give me a job. We've got a question here from someone else who's talking about did you find some staff perform better? I've just done that one. Let's move to the next one. Oh yeah, here we are. Steve the haircut Kershaw. Hi Nick, a great presentation, thank you. High number of queries resolved. Have you put other initiatives in to reduce the number of potential queries in future, apart from working just with billing?
Yeah, you bet we have. And it's we have director level engagement. Some of these are part of that customer experience initiative I told you about. So things like I mentioned a bit earlier when I was talking about purchase orders, they are the bane of my life, because ours is a reoccurring revenue model. So, you know, it's like your phone bill. You sign up to a service with us for 36, 48 months, but every year you're going to need a new purchase order, but there's no real way of getting that from people. And people just putting in ABC or Mickey Mouse, because we have a portal. Or if you're really clever, you know, you can just put a full stop, press enter, and you'll get through the system. It bypasses it. So we've put in PO processes to validate. There's now 6-point checks. So if you're PO bearing, by God, you better have a PO ready, or I'm not going to take your order. We've also, this is the real game changer. We've just rolled out for this year. The sales team used to get commissioned based on the booking of an order, not the actual, you know, go live of it. They now will only get that commission if the book, you know, once we've gone live. So they can no longer book an order for $1 million, get their commission, and then we have to work out how the hell we're going to get paid in a year's time. So that, again, fundamental changes right across the business. Everybody's involved. So there are lots of things going on, and very high level engagement. I couldn't do it on my own. We can only deal with so much at our level.
Yeah, we always say, you know, your credit managers, you can't get the best result if you do it by yourself, and that's true. Got, and interesting you talk about POs, because we've got on the 1st of July, we have got a joint accounts payable association and CICMQ best practice session. We're going to split the session in half, probably do it for 90 minutes rather than an hour. We're going to give each group a chance to sort of talk about what they do, what they need, and how they work, so that we can start to share best practice between both, so that we can give ourselves an understanding of what AP do. And one of the things that we spoke about in the best practice in the playbook that I produced a couple of months back was, you know, you've got to learn more about your AP. You've got to learn more about AP to make sure that you're working better. And I'm really pleased to say that Sharon is working very closely with the AP community at the moment, putting together their accreditation program. So I'm going to finish it there. I'm going to stop recording now, but we can stay on after the call. So I'll just say thanks very much indeed, Nick. Absolute pleasure. Brilliant presentation, as I expected it would be. And I love the montage bit in the middle. In the 1980s, you've got to have a montage, mate. You've got to have a montage. So thanks very much indeed for that. It was absolutely brilliant. Next time out, we've got Easter. So we're not going to be doing a next one. The next one will be Karen Holdstock from Arco. She's going to be on, and we'll talk a bit about Arco. Arco make and safety equipment. So that's very, very apt and very, very topical at the moment. So I'm going to stop recording now. This will be on YouTube very shortly. So thanks very much, everybody, for joining.